I'm excited to worship together this morning. You guys ready? Yeah? All right, come on. Come on, let's sing. Let's put our hands together. Joy of the Lord is my strength. Come on. Born to the darkness I was, rejected and cut off from hope. I couldn't see His love for me. They said He's not who He seems. Don't get your hopes up for healing. The lies fell away when I saw His face. Come on.
Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. We're so glad that you're with us. My name is Lynn. I'm from the Elgin campus. And it's just a privilege that you would join us this weekend. So if you would, we'd love to know where you're watching from. So go ahead and put in the chat or the comment section that where you're watching from. And that's just super, super fun for us. And if you're visiting for the first time, what an honor for us that you would choose to be with us this weekend. Well, I'm terribly excited to tell you about what happened last weekend with the Women's Conference. It's our annual conference. We called it God Over All. And can I tell you, He met us like crazy. And so I'm so excited they put together a highlight reel. So let's watch.
Mm-hmm. say, God over all. Who is God? Who is this God? Well, we can know him and meet him and encounter him and experience him in his names. Each name is a beautiful truth about who he is, perfectly revealed in scripture, beautifully incarnate in the Lord Jesus, made known to us by the Holy Spirit in our hearts and lives.
Whether you're new with us or whether you've been with us for a long time or like me, a really long time, we'd appreciate so much if you take a second and just check in. You can do that in a variety of ways. You can do it right there on the page that you're on. You can also do on your phone, on your Harvest app, or you can actually look at the links in this comment section on YouTube and on Facebook, and you can do it that way. We just love to know that you're here. We love to be praying for you through the week, so feel free to put down a prayer request as well. Well, to those of you who are not guests, I'm talking to you regular attenders, we just want to invite you to join us in giving as an act of worship. And as you know, there's four different ways that you can give. You can give right on the Harvest website. In fact, this is so cool. You can take your phone camera and hold it up to the QR code that's on the screen, and it will link you automatically right to the giving page. How cool is that? Or you can give right on your phone, on your app. You can give through a text, or you can just send in your gift to the Rolling Meadows campus. So we just appreciate so much all of your gifts and your hearts to give. Well, I'm excited to tell you that we're starting a new series today. It's on the book of Ephesians. I love this book. Dr. Michael Rydelnik is going to be bringing this series, and he's got a really cool title. He's calling it Living in Light of Our Eternal Portfolio. There's so much richness right in the title. But I'd love for you just to go grab your Bibles, and I'd like to actually read the passage that we're going to focus on today. It's Ephesians 1, verses 1 through 10. Let me read these for you. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ Jesus, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace with which he has blessed us in the beloved. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he sets forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. I'm excited to jump into that. I hope you are too. Well, as you know, Easter's right around the corner. I think it's only 3 weeks away. And I just want to I have two very special invitations for you for the Easter season here at Harvest. First, you're invited to a Seder ceremonial dinner. Okay, you might not know what that is. It's actually a traditional Jewish celebration that honors our redemption and reveals to us who Jesus is as Messiah, as the Passover Lamb. So Dr. Rydelnik is going to be with us, and he's going to actually walk us through all of the elements of what do they mean and what do they symbolize. I think it's going to be really special. So it's actually on Sunday, March 28th. It's in person from 5:30 to 7 p.m. in the Worship Center on the Rolling Meadows campus. We're going to have tables. There'll be like six people at each table. And so seating is limited. We do need you to get a ticket in advance. And you can find all that on harvestnow.info. But I also want you to know that you can participate in this online. So if you're available that Sunday morning, March 28th, you can stop by any one of our campuses and pick up a box of all of the elements. And so you can follow along at home and just enjoy the history of what this is going to be offering to all of us. And so as you check Harvest Now, make sure that you also take a look at the Good Friday options here. And we just want you to know that Good Friday this year is going to be live and in person on every single campus. It's on Friday, April 2nd. And so at 4 o'clock, there's gonna be live in-person services at Rolling Meadows and in Elgin and online. And then at 6 o'clock, we're gonna have live services on all of our campuses as well as online. So you can check harvestnow.info for all of this Easter stuff. There's also stuff about Easter Sunday, and there's also stuff about a really cool Harvest Kids birthday party that you might wanna check out. Well, as we continue in worship, I just would love it if you would just join me in prayer. Almighty Father in heaven, you have been so good to us. We just praise you this morning and this weekend. We praise you for being the God who sees us, and you're the God who hears us, and you're the God who moves in our direction so that you draw us to yourself. So I pray, Lord, that you would help us to really lean in to the eternal portfolio that Dr. Rydelnik is going to teach us about. I also pray, Lord, that you would use our serving, our giving, and our loving one another in order just to build our church for your glory, Lord. For your glory alone, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
God is worthy of our praise. Amen. Amen. Come on, stand to your feet. I am reminded and am encouraged that God inhabits the praise of his people. His word says that we enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. So as we prepare our hearts for worship this morning, as I know we've lost a little sleep, let's choose in faith to give the Lord our fullest affections and the fullness of our energy, because he is worthy of it all. So let's read Psalm 150 together, where it says, praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. And we all say together, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Together we say, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. We praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. We praise him with the harp and the lyre. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise him with timbrel and dancing. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise
Darkness, we were waiting without hope and without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. I wanna pour it out. Praise the Father. Praise the Son. Praise the Spirit. Three in one. God of glory, majesty. Praise forever to the King. Knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. Amen. till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all.
Shadows can't deny your name. It cannot be overcome.
sing the name of Jesus.
Say the name, say the name, say the name.
I'll just sing the name of Jesus.
And the name of Jesus.
I'll just sing the name of Jesus.
Every knee shall bow.
Sing the name of Jesus.
Every tongue confess.
Lord God, thank you for the safety that we can find in the victory that is in the name of Jesus Christ.
God, I am thankful.
Yeah.
Yes, I am thankful. Not even anxiety can come against you.
Yes, yes, yeah.
Lord, we love you and we magnify you. And we just set our hearts on that one thing, to magnify you in your holiness. You are perfect. And the beautiful thing that we're so thankful for, God, is the fact that you're perfect, you're holy, you're all of those things, and you love us. Who am I, God, that you are mindful of me, that you would love me? Thank you, God. So, Lord, we love you. Continue to turn our affections towards you. Ask God, would you speak to us through your word? If you want to be changed by the word of God, feel free to just even open your hands as a symbol of opening up your heart. And you can just say, if you want to say it out loud, you can say, Lord, I open up my heart to you. Lord, change me by your word. Yes, God. Let it be so. It's in that beautiful and perfect name of our Savior, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Amen, church. Man, it's really sweet to worship together, right? Amen. Amen.
I love it.
Really love it. Really do. Well, hey, let's open up God's word together. Let's go ahead and take a seat.
So glad to see you. What a great day. I got a phone call, or actually a text message early this morning about 7:30 from Sherry Smith saying, you do know that today was spring forward, daylight savings time. And I wrote her back and said, oh no. Just wanted to see what she would do. I am glad we all figured it out and we're here together. So that's great fun. It's great to be with you. I know that you heard that we're going to study Ephesians and be done by Easter. Not. That's. We're going to continue on, and I'll be with you for a bunch of weeks going through the book of Ephesians about learning how to live in light of our eternal portfolio. So that's what you're doing. Now, a lot of people call me, I've noticed, everyone here is calling me Dr. Rydelnik. It's very impressive, but you can just call me Michael. I'm totally okay with that. At school, you kind of have to do that so that you can impress the students and they might defer to you a little bit. But otherwise, I'm just totally okay being Michael. On the radio, people, what they actually told me after I was on the radio for about a year is that they were getting feedback from listeners, and they were saying on Saturday mornings that they liked this program, but how do you say that guy's name? And so I had to go on the radio and say, it's like Rye Bread, Farmer in the Dell, with a nick on the end, just like just in the nick of time. So I just think Michael's a lot easier. So feel free about that. You know, when I was in high school, I had to take algebra just like all of us, right? And one of the things that I really complained about is I didn't understand why it would be useful to me. I just couldn't figure it out. It was such a waste of time. And then I finally realized it was going to be helpful when my teacher explained to me that I could figure out baseball earned run averages if I knew algebra. So you figure a pitcher had like 125 innings, he gave up 44 runs in 125 innings. You would do a something like 44 is to 125 as X is to 9. And I said, algebra, there's value to it. I finally figured it out. And I was so happy about that. Well, today we begin our study in the book of Ephesians. And I know none of us would ever say about the book of Ephesians what I said about algebra. We're just all too spiritual to do that. However, we might think it. We might be saying like, Ephesians, are you kidding me? That's such a common book. I mean, that's the first book I ever read in the New Testament. Why don't we study something more exotic, something more special, like the book of Zechariah? Why are we studying Ephesians? Well, the reason is that Ephesians is one of the most essential books for our walk with the Lord, one of the most essential books in the whole Bible. And it's one of those books that's going to change our lives more than almost any other book in the New Testament. And so what I want to do with you is today we're gonna go through Ephesians in such detail that today we're only going to cover two verses, and it's just the hello, the salutation, the greeting. That's all it is. And that's all we're going to do today. But what I want to answer today is, why study Ephesians? Why are we going to put all these weeks into studying this book that is so essential? So why study Ephesians? Now, I know there is an outline online that you can download. How many have access to that? Anybody here? Oh, good. Look at you. There's the really savvy ones. You've got it pulled up. Some of you printed it in advance. I really want to encourage you to do that. Let me just encourage you. I'll be using outlines as we go through this series. And so see if you can get that. Also, I have a brand new Bible. I normally don't use the English Standard Version. I usually use the Holman Christian Standard Version. But what an opportunity to read a new Bible. So I've got a new Bible, so I'm going to bring my Bible every week, and I'm going to encourage you to do the same, because we'll be looking at the verses in the Bible, actually. The thing I want you to do is bring an actual, if you can, bring an actual Bible, not your phone or your iPad. There's something about paper and ink that really, really helps. I don't know why that is, but studies have shown that what we read in a book is actually more valuable to us than what we read on a screen. So it's more retained, at least. So if you have a Bible, let's get it out. What we're gonna do is we're going to read the opening words. And what I want to do as we read this, we're going to look at four reasons we're going to study Ephesians. Four reasons, and they're all drawn right from this salutation, okay? Here's Ephesians 1, verses 1 and 2. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus. Now, I often substitute the word Messiah when I see the word Christ, and the reason I do that is that's what Christ means. It means anointed one. The Hebrew word for anointed is Messiah, and the Greek word for anointed is Christos, and so I frequently just substitute the word Messiah because, you know, when I was a kid, And the first time I ever really heard about Jesus, this is just free, I'm not going to charge for this. First time I ever heard about Jesus, and I heard that he was supposed to be the Messiah and that Christ meant the Messiah, I said, oh, so that's what, I thought it was a last name. You know, Joseph Christ, Mary Christ, Jesus Christ. When I heard that Jesus Christ means Jesus the Messiah, as a Jewish kid growing up in New York, I'm like, oh, you mean he's Jewish? You know, it was just, it was a shock to me. And so I think because of that, I always tend to substitute the word Messiah for Christ. So Paul, an apostle of Messiah Jesus, by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Messiah Jesus, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus, the Messiah. Well, there are four clear reasons right from these words about why we're going to study Ephesians. Here's the first one. We're studying Ephesians because it discloses God's message to us. We're studying Ephesians because it discloses God's message to us. You see the author, it says Paul, and then he calls himself the apostle of the Messiah Jesus. The word apostle means a sent one. I'm sure you've heard that. But it actually comes from, you know, Paul, Jewish upbringing, comes from a Jewish concept. There is a concept called a shaliach. A shaliach means a sent one, but it had an official role. For example, if the rabbis made a decision in Israel, in Jerusalem, or in Tiberias, when they were making decisions, they would then send a shaliach into the whole diaspora to let the whole world know, all the whole Jewish world know, what the rabbis had decided in Jerusalem. And the shaliach went out, and he went with the full authority of those who sent him. And so the idea of a shaliach is one that has the authority of the one who sent. And that's what an apostle is. When the Lord Jesus named the apostles, they were being sent out by him with his full authority. And so when Paul says, I am an apostle, Paul, an apostle of Messiah Jesus, what he is saying is, I am being sent to you, I am writing to you with the full authority of the Lord Jesus. That's what he's saying. He is claiming authority. And he says, I'm not claiming this on my own. He says, it's by the will of God. God's the one that made me this. The emphasis that Paul is making when he identifies himself as an apostle according to the will of God is, and this is what's important for us, is he has an authoritative message that must be listened to. That's why I am saying that the emphasis here is this is an authoritative message. It is disclosing God's word, God's message to us. He is making a point. There's no question Paul knew this was the word of God. He is a shaliach. He is a representative of the one who sent him, of the Lord Jesus. This is his message. It's so crucial for us to understand this. This is not a book of good advice. It is not a self-help book. Do you ever notice how so much preaching today sounds like psychobabble, pop psychology? It's not, thus saith the Lord. Unfortunately, we have gotten into, you know, how is this going to really help me? Well, the thing is, it's going to help us if we recognize that this is God's authoritative word. And it's going to actually speak to the issues in our life. That's what's so crucial about it. When you think about what this book deals with, it deals with theology. Obviously, theology is teachings that will change our lives. It also deals with issues like bigotry between Jews and Gentiles. And of course, that's very applicable to our lives as well. It deals with issues like having peace, like how to serve God. That would be really good. How to serve God with our gifts. That's here in this book. And not only that, this book deals with family relationships, work relationships. It deals with spiritual warfare. It deals with so many practical issues in our lives. That's why we're studying it, because it is God's message to us. We dare not miss it. Second reason we're studying Ephesians is because It discloses our spiritual status before God. You see who he wrote to? The recipients of this book are the faithful saints in the Messiah Jesus at Ephesus. He says to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful. He's talking to faithful saints in the Messiah Jesus. It's actually, I just want you to know, it's not just to them. It was a circular letter. It went to the Ephesians, but it went to all the churches around Ephesus. It was a circular letter because it was God's word. And he is calling them saints. Now, what does a saint mean to you and me? I mean, think about it. When we hear the word saint, you know, Saint Aloysius or something like that, the modern view is a person officially recognized for holiness of life. So the first qualification to be a saint is a saint must be dead. That's not such a great way to start, but that's what, you must be dead. You must have had an exemplary character. A saint must have performed two miracles. Ambrose Pierce says a saint is nothing but a dead sinner revised and edited because they're really cleaned up. The biblical view of what a saint is, it means to be set apart, person who is made holy by God, declared holy by God. It relates to our calling, not our behavior. The reason I mention this, I don't know if you've ever seen that, if you read Leviticus or Numbers, there are these artifacts in the temple, a laver, for example, or a pitcher for water or something like that, and they're called holy vessels. Well, how can an inanimate object be holy? It's because they are set apart for the worship of God. They're not alive, but they're set apart. And so when we are called holy ones, saints, all it means is that when we came to know the Lord Jesus, he took us and set us apart for him. We are there here to serve him. That's what it means to be a saint. We are set apart for service to him. It's not a special elite group of people. It's about followers of Jesus, like you and like me. We are saints. This book will explain how to become a saint. In fact, in this verse, it calls them the faithful. Those who have faith in Jesus. You read Ephesians 2, it talks about those who have faith by grace through faith. If we experience God's grace through faith, guess what? And I really hope this is true of all of us. We, every one of us here, are saints. Now, if you have never yet put your trust in Jesus, let me just assure you that it's really easy to become a saint. No effort whatsoever. It's just recognizing that we did things wrong, we've sinned, that Jesus died to take the punishment for those wrong things. He was raised again, proving he's God, and we trust that that's all that is necessary to come into a forgiven relationship with God. That's it. We trust in Jesus. And if you make that decision right now, I can call you a saint. I made that decision, so I am actually Saint Michael. So you didn't know that. My wife certainly has never experienced that, but I am indeed Saint Michael. Now you look at this congregation of saints in the New Testament. We know more about the saints in Ephesus than any other church in the New Testament, any other congregation. And I really want to encourage you to read Acts 18 through 20, because that's where you'll find out about it. This is a congregation that was established on Paul's third missionary journey. He was so effective there, he decided to spend 2.5 years. He started a Bible institute there to teach them the word. Paul spent a good deal of time in Ephesus doing this. There were a number of life transformations, so much so that it caused a big hubbub there because Paul caused a riot because there were so many people that became believers there. The book, in Acts 20, Paul says farewell to the Ephesian elders. He has to go back to Jerusalem. We also, I'm sure you don't realize this because most people don't know, but we have two books written to the pastor of the Ephesians, 1st and 2nd Timothy. Timothy became the pastor of the Ephesians. And so we can look at Paul near the end of his life, about 10 years after he founded this church in 53. In the early 60s, he writes to Timothy. And so we can see about what's going on in Ephesus there. And then, of course, we know that the Lord Jesus gave a letter to the Ephesians in Revelation chapter 2. To give them a message, and so we can see them up into the 90s. We know a lot about this church. Now, what are the characteristics of this church? We wouldn't recognize it way too much for us, but this is what they were like. They were very strong on doctrine, and they were also weak on application. How do we know this? If you look at Revelation chapter 2, the Lord Jesus actually, you don't have to turn there, but I'll read you something that's really important about what he says to the Ephesian church. He says, I know your works, your toil and your patient endurance, how you cannot bear with those who are evil, but have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and found them to be false. I know you are enduring patiently and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown weary, but I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. They knew how to test an apostle, but it was because they were sound on doctrine, but they didn't love Jesus the way they did when they first came to know him. That was the Ephesian church. That's, I think, the primary characteristics that you find in the Ephesian church. And now, what I think is interesting is Paul is writing this letter to the Ephesians, and it's almost like he anticipates what they're going to become because he has to exhort them here 35 years before the Lord Jesus gave that letter in Revelation 2. 35 years earlier, he has to remind them of their position in the Lord. He has to remind them of their portfolio, their wealth in heaven, so that they will live in light of it. They were strong on doctrine, but weak on application. I find that's true in my life. Unfortunately, I spend a lot of time studying the Bible. What do you mean, unfortunately? I cannot live it completely. I wish I were better at application. You know, that's where I need to live. I need to try to live. I don't want to live in the area of knowing a lot and not living it a lot. That's the danger that we have if we become like the Ephesians. Now, studying the book of Ephesians will teach us to live in conformity with our status. That's why we're studying this. Because we're saints, officially saints, but we want to live like saints. Not only are we called holy ones, if we obey the book of Ephesians, we'll become holy, in fact. Some of us have further to go than others. Let's be honest. Some of us are closer to holiness than others of us. I mean, how many of you know my really good friend, Dr. Michael Van Lanningham? Yeah, he really needs this book. Now, his wife, Sue Van Lanningham, we call her affectionately Saint Sue. She doesn't have very far to go. She's living in holiness. She's just, but you know what? Wherever you're at the beginning of the process, or close to complete obedience, where there's always more we can learn. There's always more application that we can have. There's always more faithfulness that we can build, God can build into our lives by studying this book and determining to obey it. So that's why we're studying this. I think wherever we're at, studying the book of Ephesians will do us good. Well, there's a third reason we're studying Ephesians. It's because it demonstrates where we come from. You say, well, we don't come from Ephesus. He writes right here in Ephesians 2. He says to the saints who are in Ephesus, we don't come from Ephesus. Well, let me tell you a little bit about Ephesus, and then you'll see it really does speak to where we come from. The city of Ephesus is extremely similar to the city of Chicago. There you can see it. You see that the Aegean Sea, and there's Turkey. Let's see if I'm getting this on the right side. Yeah, Turkey on this side, and Athens on this side, Greece and Turkey. And that's Ephesus is on the coast there of what is Turkey today. It was Asia Minor at one time. So it's there in Turkey. Politically, it was the leading city of Asia. There were 250,000 people that lived in Ephesus. It wasn't the capital, but it was most important. Just like Chicago is not the capital of Illinois, Springfield is, but it's the most important city in Illinois and probably one of the most important cities in the whole United States. Commercially, Ephesus was a port city. It was a center of trade. It was a banking city. Had a great deal of banking because of the Temple of Artemis that was there, and it functioned as a bank. It explains the emphasis on terms in Ephesus in the book of Ephesians, like riches, inheritance, things like that. It was the greatest commercial center in Asia, is what Strabo wrote. Now, if Carl Sandburg described Ephesus, he would have called it the city of the big shoulders, hog butcher of the world. That's what he would have called it, just like he called Chicago. It was an enormously important city, both politically and commercially. It's also important religiously. The temple there was the Temple of Artemis, or the Temple of Diana. It dominated the city. There's the ruins right there of the Temple of Diana as it stands now. Antipater classified it as one of the seven wonders of the world. And it explains the emphasis on the congregation being a new temple in Ephesians 2, 20 through 22. Here's what an artist's rendering was of what it would have looked like. It's massive. It was much bigger than the Parthenon. The Parthenon in Greece, that's what I was talking about. It is tremendously important. It also had a very important goddess, the goddess Diana, and we actually can see what she looked like. She was a fertility goddess. That's why she is depicted the way she is. The priestesses dominated the city, the priestesses of Diana, and it explains why Paul has to deal with the role of women in the local congregation in 1 Timothy 2, because they had a very dominant issue. There was a great deal of magic because of the paganism there. The Temple of Artemis led to a great deal of magic. There were 6 magical Ephesian letters in that time. The city had a reputation of being a center of magical practices, which is why there was the uproar in Acts 19, and also it explains why Paul has to write so much about spiritual warfare in Ephesians 6, because it was a city of occult magic. Intellectually, it was the seat of learning. It was a university city, is what you would say. It had University of Chicago and Northwestern combined, which is why Paul had to rent the school of Tyrannus and start a school there to teach people. It was an intellectual center. Here's the most important thing we can know about Ephesus. It was morally bankrupt. It was morally bankrupt. First century Ephesus was a dark place. It was filled with immorality. It was filled with idolatry. It had the occult. It had pagan sacrifices. The darkness was so overwhelming in Ephesus that Paul had to remind the Ephesians to live as children of light. And I think that's the greatest correspondence. When I say it reveals where we live in a very dark city. Sometimes we forget that. But for example, the murder rate in Chicago, which was large already, jumped in 2020 by 50%. In 2019, there were 495 murders. In 2020, there were 769. Shootings in the city of Chicago went from 2,146 to 3,246. And this is just the city. It doesn't contain all of Chicagoland. Our city, our area that we live in is characterized by immorality, violent crime, gangs, political corruption. I mean, think about how many governors we've had in prison, right? It is a very dark place to live. I mean, where I teach at Moody Bible Institute, and then just a mile north, there's the historic Moody Church. Right in between, there's a huge Planned Parenthood office, which is killing babies every day. We live in a very dark city. And that's why Paul had to remind the Ephesians, and he reminds us to live as light. Now, this is what we are going to learn in the book of Ephesians. I'd like to turn down the house lights completely. Let's get dark in here. This is what we are going to be. Lights. Now we can bring them back. Lights in a dark world. Studying the book of Ephesians enables us to shine the light. Because as we, oh, look at that, it's still flashing. As we shine the light in a dark world, as we're obedient, we will be shining the light of Jesus in a very dark place. It's why we need it, because it shows us where we live. We live in a very dark place. So why are we studying Ephesians? It's God's message to us. It discloses our spiritual status as saints. It demonstrates where we come from, a very dark place, but we are light in the Lord. And here's the fourth reason. We're studying Ephesians because it discloses our spiritual wealth from God. It's got all about our inheritance. And if you look at the salutation again, the opening words, Paul greets them by saying, grace to you and peace. You've noticed that in New Testament greetings, haven't you? Grace to you and peace. Paul does it, Peter does it. It's not an unusual greeting, but it was an unusual greeting in the first century. Here's why. In the Greco-Roman world, people would greet each other in a letter by saying, grace to you. In the Jewish world, people would start a letter and say, Shalom Aleichem, peace be unto you. Only in this world, the world of the New Testament, with New Testament writers, do they unite those two ideas, grace to you and peace. And there's a number of reasons. I mean, you can see in Ephesians 2, the reconciliation of Jew and Gentile. Jews and Gentiles, one in the Messiah, one in the body, right there with complete reconciliation. So he unites it that way. But really what it emphasizes when Paul says, grace to you and peace, he's emphasizing two ideas. God's unbelievable wealth of kindness that he has shown us. That's what grace means. You've heard undeserved favor. Favor or kindness. It emphasizes undeserved kindness to us from God. And peace, it emphasizes the idea that now we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus, and therefore we can have peace with others. Our sins are forgiven. We're not at odds with God anymore. We're at peace with him. We have wholeness now, and we can have wholeness with others. And so when we study these opening words, grace and peace, it emphasizes really all the wealth that we have in the Messiah Jesus. Isn't that amazing? We have an inheritance that we would have never dreamed of, and we'll be studying all about that. But that's the big picture, grace and peace. When I was a kid, there was a TV show I used to watch. I think it was even in reruns when I was a kid, like when I'd stay home from school, when I'd pretend I had a stomach ache or something because I had a test that day. And come on, you did it too. But anyway, and I would sit there and watch TV in the morning. There was a show called The Millionaire. And a guy named Michael Anthony would show up with $1 million, which back then was real money, you know. And some great benefactor would give $1 million, his representative would come and give someone $1 million. And the show that day would be how that money affected people. And they became wealthy instantly. They didn't know it. Wow, this is amazing. And sometimes they did good, and sometimes they did real bad. That was the point. The point of studying the book of Ephesians is I feel like I'm Michael Anthony. I am the person coming here. I'm not giving you the money. Neither was Michael Anthony. But I am coming here, and I am saying, this is the check that God has written. It is the wealth that's in the bank for us, the bank of heaven. It is part of our eternal portfolio. And we're going to study, we're going to get out the books, and we're going to see how wealthy we are in the Messiah. How wealthy we are in Jesus. And then what we're going to do is we're going to see how we should live so we don't mess up, so we don't blow it the way they did in that TV show so often, but that we live in light of that portfolio. That's what, so I'm coming here with the check, but I didn't write it, only God did. I'm only the messenger to say that God has written it. Now, I want you to take a look at this overview. Do we have it here on the screen? There we go. This, by the way, this is the one thing that my son thinks I do well as a teacher. He says, you do really good charts. I don't know how accurate that is, but he wants me to do a book of every book in the Bible, a chart of every book in the Bible. So there we have it. Okay, so look at it. This is what we have is some keywords. There's sit, walk, stand are three keywords. Chapters 1 through 3 really are about the believer's wealth, what our position is in the heavenlies. And then chapters 4 through 6, 9 is about our walk, how do we practice in the word. And then chapters 6, 10 through the end is our warfare, the believer's warfare, our protection from the enemy. That's the big picture. I do think it's interesting. Now, you have to go back to grammar school, but chapters 1 through 3 only has one command. It's filled with indicatives. This is what we are. Then in chapters 4 through 6, it's filled with imperatives. This is what we do. This is what God expects of us. That's the big picture of the book of Ephesians. And really, if you put it together, what Paul is saying is we are seated in the heavenlies with the Lord Jesus. We have a tremendous inheritance from him. And now we need to live in light of it. We have to live in light of that portfolio in terms of our walk and our warfare. That's what the book's about. Now, I do believe that's online, is it not? And you can download it, correct? So paste it into your Bible, put it on your bulletin board, do anything you want with it. But that's a good summary of the book of Ephesians. Okay. So let's think about why we're studying it. Why are we studying the book of Ephesians? Well, first of all, because, can I remember them in order? We're studying the book of Ephesians because it's God's message to us. We're studying the book of Ephesians because it discloses our spiritual status, because it reveals where we're from, the city of Chicago. It discloses our spiritual wealth and teaches us to live in light of it. That's what it's about. Now, having done that, we've covered two verses. We've got the salutation down. I always like to pull things together by saying, now what? Not so what, but now what do I do? And so I want to give you an assignment because I'm a teacher, so here's your assignment for the book of Ephesians for next week. Okay, here's the first one. I'd like for you to read the book of Ephesians this week. And you get bonus points if you read Acts 18 through 20 as well. Okay, so read the whole book of Ephesians this week. There's a couple ways you can read the book of Ephesians, okay? One way you can read it is read a chapter a day. There's six chapters, and after 6 days, you'll have read it. And then next Sunday, we'll be back together, and we'll be picking up Ephesians 1, 3 through 7, and you'll say, I know all about this because I've read a chapter a day. Okay, that's one way we can do it. Now, here's an alternate way to do it. Read the whole book of Ephesians every day this week. It's six chapters. It takes 15 minutes at best. Could take 10 minutes if you're a good reader. Okay, read it out loud. Read it quietly. read it in one sitting every day for 6 days. And the seventh day, you can just come to church. But, or you can read it that day too. Read it for a week. That's even better. And then get those bonus points in by reading Acts 18 through 20 to figure out the setting of the book of Ephesians about how the gospel came to Ephesus. Now, that's the first step. The second one is write down every spiritual blessing we have in the Messiah Jesus. Now, I want to show you this. This is a notebook. Okay. It's my notebook. It cost me $2 at CVS, just so you see it. I think it was on sale. And when I read the Bible, just for myself, not for teaching or anything like that, I write down stuff. Any idea, anything I see, I just write it down. I'm going to clue you in. We should never read the Bible without a pen and a notebook. Get out a pen. It doesn't have to be an expensive notebook. It could be one of those old composition notebooks. Get a notebook. Get a pad. Get something and write down what you're reading. And what I mean by this is, as you read, find every blessing that's mentioned there in the book of Ephesians and write it down. Make a list. And then secondly, you read it the next day. I'm sorry, not second. The next day, if you see more, write it down. Write it down. Okay, here's the third step. Mark every command that you can find and write it in here. What are we commanded to do? Every imperative, write it down. You might want to make one page blessings and one page commands. How's that? Divide it. And then you're going to see what Paul is saying is this is the wealth we have. This is the way we should live in light of that wealth. Okay, so read the book. Write down all the benefits. Write down all the commands. Now, here's the most important step. The most important step is this week, say, I am going to live in light of my wealth. It takes a decision. I am deciding now if I've been not living as closely to the portfolio that God has given me, if I am kind of straying, now I am deciding as I read this book and as we study it, I am determined to live in light of that wealth. That's the decision we have to make. Now, many have lived through the Great Depression, and they lived kind of poorly. I want to tell you the story of Grace Groner. She was especially restrained with her money. She got her clothes from rummage sales. She lived in a very small house. She didn't own a car. She took public transportation, or she walked. Her house had one bedroom. She had mismatched furniture. It wasn't very nice. She only had a big TV. That was the one thing she had, but a very, very small house. Her one splurge that she did is when, 1935, she bought 3 sets of shares in Abbott Labs for $60 each, for $180. When she died, she left $7 million to Lake Forest College. She lived like a pauper, even though she was extremely wealthy. Here's what I want to remind us. We have an immense portfolio of eternal riches that we have from Jesus. We dare not be the great spiritual Grace Groners. We have to live in this life, in this world, in light of that spiritual portfolio that we have. We must live in light of our wealth. That's the decision we need to make. Let's pray. Father, help us to be people who live as light in a dark world, who live as spiritually wealthy and obedient to you based on the wealth you have given us. Help us to be the people who are transformed by you through our study of the word in the book of Ephesians.
favor on us. Everywhere we go, your grace is on our side. Your grace is on our side. Whatever comes our way, God be lifted high. Your love will never fail. We will testify. Everywhere we go, your grace is on our side.
You were just blown away by the eternal portfolio. And I also hope that you were moved to come back with us next weekend as we continue the study in the book of Ephesians. Before you go, I just want to remind you, make sure to check out harvestnow.info for all the Easter information, Good Friday, the Seder dinner, and the Harvest Kids Easter birthday party. And one last thing, if you are ready, or I should say when you're ready, we sure would love to see you in person on any one of our campuses. So as you go this week, I pray that you are reminded often that you are loved.